during my PhD work, you know about that. There's some labs that I've worked more closely with, and I've had the chance to exchange with Apostolos and Laurent from the JRC on the issue of mobile botnets and many other issues before Apostolos arrived, actually. But not because of that, but because he was chosen by the program committee. He's going to present about the platform that they designed, and further on with Laurent in 40 minutes, we'll get an update on their project. So, Apostolos, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. My name is Apostolos Malatras, as Eric just said, and together with my colleague Laurent Bellet, we are going to present to you our work on mobile botnets, the particularities of mobile botnets, and an experimental platform, a hybrid experimental platform that we have designed and are in the process of developing to do a mobile botnet research in a systematic manner. First of all, let me thank a lot the people from Kaspersky before, who did a very good job at introducing the threat landscape of mobile malware and mobile botnets, because it really validates the purpose of work like the ones that we are doing. Moreover, just let me apologize also in advance, because I'm guessing you have seen our names, you know we're doing about mobile botnets. We have spammed you a lot in the last few weeks about something that Laurent will talk about later. And thank you very much for your contributions in advance. So the outline of the presentation today is, first I'm going to motivate to build a bit up on the motivation on why we're doing this work, why mobile botnets are an actual threat, and what we're doing on trying to do some research on it and study them. Discuss a bit the particularities of mobile botnets, and then I'm going to go ahead and present to you the design of the hybrid experimental platform that we have implemented in order to study mobile botnets in the lab, and its implementation and some experiments that we've been planning ahead in this respect. So, mobile botnets are a threat. They are out there. The botnets do not restrict themselves nowadays only to PCs, Macs, or other computing devices that are existing only in the home environment. As we'll see later on, the pervasiveness and the ubiquitiness of mobile devices and the fact that these devices have very advanced capabilities has allowed a lot of mobile malware to be deployed and to infect a mobile device as well. The thing that motivated our research is the fact that we wanted to do some experiments with mobile malware. We wanted to study how these are used to infect devices, how these mobile botnets are propagated from device to device, how detection takes place on these kind of devices. And we found that there was not really nice, systematic, uniform, organized manner of doing so. And by systematic, I mean that's something that would allow us to repeat experiments from other people and would allow other people to repeat experiments that we were doing. Because at the end of the day, when we're doing research, we would like to have this feature. I had this problem when I was doing my PhD. I was starting doing PhD on ad hoc networks in 2003. And there was no simulator back then, no emulator that everybody was using. So I was reading papers and seeing some results, trying to repeat these experiments, and these things didn't turn out to be as the things that I was reading. So similar with other fields of study, networks, and in particular, where we have well-established simulators and emulator platforms like PlanetLab, like NS2, we would like to have a similar platform in order to be able to do mobile botnet research. It would allow for a well-defined, established way for experimentation. It would allow to facilitate the exchange of results and discuss a bit more on the experimental semantics. It would allow also to do more scalable and more flexible experiments, because let's face it, mobile botnet experiments are kind of limited in the sense that when you're in the lab, it's kind of limited on the number of devices that are available to us. We cannot have hundreds of devices. So that's why we decided to go for a hybrid platform, as I'm going to discuss, in order to allow for emulated and real devices to be integrated in the same environment. And it would definitely facilitate development efforts, because we could do some trial and error before doing some actual things in the wild, and promote uniformity and common practices, as I mentioned there. So mobile botnets and mobile botnet malware, as has been discussed already before, and it's actually a real threat. A mobile botnet is a botnet that it runs on mobile devices. And it's not something that came we decided, OK, it's a nice thing to explore. Maybe somebody hasn't thought of it before. We started to study it, and we started to do research about it because there are mobile botnets available out there. There are botnets that have infected a lot of mobile devices. And actually, we have collected a few samples as well now lately. And this is the reason that we decided to do research about it. It's a collection of compromised mobile machines that is run under a bootmaster. And the reason that they are quite popular lately is the fact that, as I said before, mobile devices are pervasive. They're always with us. They're always on. They're always connected to the network, unlike some fixed computers or some home computers. So they're always connected to the network, and they allow operations, botnet operations, to be conducted on them. Moreover, there are quite a few security vulnerabilities, as was covered before in the presentations by the people from Kaspersky. The big fact is that there are a lot of different versions of operating systems, and each one of them has different security vulnerabilities. We cannot realistically expect that people patch up their operating system every single day so that to counter all these vulnerabilities and to reduce the number of risks. So the risks are still out there. Applications have different levels of permissions, and the permission model can be bypassed in order to conduct covert operations. And lately, we have seen a big convergence of mobile systems with traditional computing systems. So mobile devices are used as backup for computing systems, so they're easily connected also to corporate networks, to fixed PCs. And this brings up a rich ecosystem where botmasters and malicious botnet owners can have their playground. Why mobile botnets are particularly interesting? Another reason is that they're tightly linked to a user account. They're very personal, because when somebody infects your device, nowadays we have a lot of stuff on our devices, from banking account information to personal information and photos. They're also, many of them are linked with paying system, mobile payment system. They're linked to big monetary values, so people can steal can use them to perform purchases on your behalf. And more importantly, personal information, personal and very sensitive information that can be used for ransomware later on and so forth. People can also use mobile botnets, and this has been established, to send SMSs to premium services, and thus can get more lucrative gains. Botnets are, as always, composed of the standard stuff: botmaster, CNC server and client bot. The particularities of mobile botnets lay in the fact in two main things. Firstly, I'll go for the second one first, because I covered it previously, the financial gains. So phones are acting as mobile wallets. SMS and premium numbers, people can steal a lot of money before you even notice it. So in a few hours, people can steal a lot of money from your phone, and then you'll get a notification from your bank, someone, unusual activity has been noticed. And second, then, one aspect that we find extremely interesting is the fact of contextualization. Mobile phones have a wealth of sensor information on them, and they're also tightly connected to your user account. So when I say onboard sensors can be used to infer a lot of different context information. For example, your location, the state of the user, if he's walking, running, or if he's doing some other activity, proximity to other users, also preferences in terms of the user profile. All this information allow for more targeted and more focused types of attacks to be performed. So it's possible, for example, to be able to have a mobile botnet that targets the users only in this particular room, or only in the vicinity of Paris, or people that only, for example, are in a particular state, only runners, and so forth. And this ability to contextualize attacks makes it very interesting in terms of the attackers, because they can focus the target space in terms of their particular requirements. So for example, they could focus it on a group of employees of a particular company based on the proximity that has been noticed and the Wi-Fi access points that they are connecting to. So it opens up a nice field for attack. Mobile botnets have some more technical particularities as well. in terms of dynamic IP addressing, because they're connecting to different access points all the time, they can be used, or also the 3G networks and 4G networks that people are using. There are particular constraints in terms of networking that are imposed by the cellular networks. So when you're using your 3G connection, you have to go through the telco corporate network, the telco network, and so forth. As I mentioned before, and that's a big vulnerability, the fact that there is a huge number of different operating system versions increases a lot the size of the vulnerabilities, the number of the vulnerabilities. The size of the screen is itself a vulnerability. You saw before about the hardware, how easy it is for people to get infected and download APKs on their phone. The fact that the screen is so small, sometimes we press things and you don't really know if you are accepting something or something, you clicked on something that you didn't know of. You have to zoom in sometimes in order to make sure that you clicked on the right thing. Another very important thing is the fact of the sensors, not only for contextualization, as I mentioned before, but sensors can be used and have been used as a side channel for communication. So, for example, the light sensor on the phone has been used to trigger a particular botnet command, in the sense that the person is passing by in front of a pulsing light, and that pulsing light is detected by the sensor on the mobile phone as a particular type of command and interpreted like that. So, side channels for communication open up a completely new different way of for bot masters and CNCs to contact the bots that are installed on mobile devices. Clearly, that's really not well. That's not an aspect, a parameter that has been widely out there so far. It's a bit more exotic, but it opens up the opportunity for the attackers. And altogether, it's not a little tightly controlled ecosystem. It's highly recommended that we use the Google Play Store, the Amazon Store to download applications, but especially with the Google Play, off-market installations is a risk. And people are doing a lot of off-market installations. So when we worked together with Eric on mobile botnets, we built a taxonomy of mobile botnet features in order to be able to classify the different particularities of mobile botnets in comparison to traditional botnets. And we studied different aspects like the network and connectivity issues, the platforms that people are using, the architecture, different means to propagate the infection, and the means that are used for this infection, the target of the attack, the motivation, impact, the detection. I will not go into detail on this because the focus of this presentation is mostly on the platform, and I've seen that I've been talking a lot about mobile botnets and not the platform itself so far. But in terms of the architecture, that's something that is interesting to know, it's that on mobile botnets, we have the four different standard types of architectures, the centralized, hierarchical, hybrid, and mostly common are the peer-to-peer ones, because they allow, they're based on the proximity, and proximity is a feature that is well exploited in terms of mobile botnet malware. So, having said all this, we wanted, okay, not just to map the domain, to map what is happening in terms of mobile botnets. We wanted also to be able to test mobile botnets in the lab to see how they are used to infect, how they are used to propagate in other devices. And in general, we want to support a variety of experiments in regards to mobile botnets. And we wanted to do it in a systematic manner. That's why we started building, and this is an ongoing exploratory work, this hybrid experimental platform. When I say hybrid, it's because it's using both real devices that we have in the lab and that are part of the network of our ecosystem, but also emulated ones, and we're using emulators, Android emulators for that. The platform we designed had a specific set of design goals that, and features. We wanted it to be generic enough so that it covers a lot of different types and architecture of mobile botnets, but also different configurations for operating systems and different types of networks, from Wi-Fi and 3G to 4G and Bluetooth networks. Eventually, we would like to cover other channels of communication, as I mentioned before. We wanted also to be scalable. Mobile botnets can be as small as a few devices, a few tens of devices, but can grow up to thousands of devices, as some of the data was displayed before. And also, we'd like to have the possibility to run experiments of more than one botnet. Would also like for the platform to be extensible, to allow for dynamic reconfiguration of the experiments, and be quite usable in the sense that we would want the users of this platform to write source code in order to be able to run an experiment. We wanted to do it in a user-friendly manner. For this purpose, we built this platform here, as you say. The important thing to note is, as I mentioned before, and I think this is something quite interesting to us as well, is the fact that this is the hybrid platform. We're also using actual devices that we're infecting and cleaning afterwards, and emulated devices as well. So even if the malware itself has some of the malwares that we would be testing have some sort of testing to realize whether they are running in a virtualized environment, we could also just use the standalone real devices for that. The focus of the platform, the main element, is the experiment manager. And the experiment manager module is where we go and define the experiment that we want to run. That experiment can be for as simple as that is this malware APK, install it on the devices and see how they are running together, what is happening, what is the network traffic that is being generated, where are these devices trying to connect to, whether they are discussing with each other. It can be also something more complex. So, for example, we could build, if it's a peer-to-peer mobile botnet malware, we can define the topology of the network that we want based on the devices that are available to us. We could find also some optimization criteria, for example, what to do when the CPU utilization reaches a certain level, or what to do when we have collected enough data, or what to do if the network traffic reaches a particular level. The experiment manager is used by the users at a very high level to define their experiment in the sense of number of nodes, number types of operating systems used. For now, it's just Android, but in theory, we should expand later on to other operating systems. And then we're using different modules, as are shown here, the task analyzer, task allocation, optimization, and objective evaluation. These are used to parse the high-level sort of natural language definition of the experiment given by the users to the low-level instructions that are going to be passed on to the devices eventually. The task analyzer defines breaks down the experiment into different pieces of instructions to be given to the devices, and the task allocation assigns them to each particular device based on the requirements. So if an experiment can run only on an emulated device or only on a real device. The objective evaluation is optional and can be used by the user to define whether particular objectives will be set in order to run the experiment, and optimization keeps track of the whole operation of the experiment to see that the utilization of the resources is not exceeded. When the experiment has been defined and is ready to be executed, we move on to the emulation manager, which is the core of the platform. And in there, the actual communication with the real and the emulated devices takes place. So the high-level codified instructions are translated into Android-specific or emulator-specific instructions to be sent to the devices by means of the setup and the execute modules. And the monitor module keeps track of whatever information is coming from the real devices, whatever information we have asked from it to monitor. So as I said before, monitor traffic, exchange information, exchange SMSs, and so forth. What is really important is the fact that, as I said before, the very interesting for us is the fact of contextualization by means of sensor information. And that is really important for mobile botnet malware. That's why we wanted to have this included in the platform. We realized that if we just have a static platform with no sensor information available to us, it would be like another sandbox. So in this particular case, we have a module here in the settings where we're emulating realistic fake data, as we call them, through this oxymoron. Sensor data that is fed to the devices in order to emulate real conditions. So location is moved, we can select the desired movement patterns of the nodes and have this location fed to the devices so as to emulate the GPS sensor. We can also have accelerometer settings emulated, gyroscope settings, magnetometer, and so forth. And this way, the actual static devices that nobody's really touching and the emulated ones seems to be having some sort of a movement, seem to be having actual data to be exploited by the mobile botnet malware. The devices that are running can be quite a few. This actually depends on our resources in terms of money, because okay, the real device we have to buy and we have to set up and we have to maintain all the time. And the second resource is the computation power. So the Android emulators are running on a cluster on a server now, which will be expanded to a cluster of servers soon. And it's a matter of the CPU and the RAM that we have available to us to run more Android emulator instances. Another important parameter is the results. The results are defined also at the beginning of the experiments and can cover different aspects such as propagation, infection, how many devices have been infected, how much consumption of resources the mobile botnet malware consumes, and so forth. The architecture, as we have designed, has been implemented up until now at a prototype level, and we are testing it for us for now. And eventually, when it becomes a bit more stable and more generic, will be shared. So what the platform can do at the end of the day is, first of all, test mobile botnets, infection, distribution, and detection. We can test different parameters in order to see how these parameters influence the infection distribution aspects of the mobile botnet. And we can observe the operation of mobile botnets in a contained environment by means of real and emulated devices. The platform itself is not connected to any real network. It runs in a contained networking environment, so we don't have any instances of actual botnets in the wild that are collaborating with the platform. The way we define the scenario, the way the platform works, is by means of a definition of a scenario. So the user of the one that wants to run some sort of experiment with mobile botnets, they define the scenario, which is like a list of events. So they have a series of steps that show the way they would like their experiment to run. For example, first step, infect the botnet, install the malware, keep track of this and that, X and Y parameters, and so forth. Clearly, we can run the experiment in a remote manner, so where the actual devices are and where the servers are can be done, configuration can be done in a remote manner, and so we can have a data center there, hopefully. We can collect the results and runtime measurements, we can integrate realistic sensor data, and we can run parallel experiments, so more than one mobile botnet running at the same time, clearly subject to the availability of the resources, which at this level are quite restricted since it's just for us. The platform that I just described, we have started implementing by means of open technologies, basically using Java technologies. In terms of the emulator, we're focused now only on the Android platform because the security model can be bypassed here, as I said before, with the root access. So we're using the Android emulator for the emulated devices and rooted devices for the real devices. The Android debug bridge is enabled on all devices so as to allow us to communicate remotely with them. Configuration is defined. The scenarios that I mentioned before with events are by means of XML configurable files. And the realistic fake sensor data, we're using an open source tool called Sensor Simulator for that to integrate in the platform. So the infrastructure up until now we've been testing it in scenarios like this. So the server, the main server where the Android emulators are running, currently mimics the behavior of the botmaster. So the botmaster setups the configuration that they want. And we're using a Raspberry Pi to have as a CNC server. The reason that we use the Raspberry Pi and not another server is the fact that we wanted the CNC server to emulate something more realistic in a mobile environment. The fact that the CNC might be in a more portable type of device and more restrained in terms of resources. Android smartphones are controlled by means of the Raspberry Pi. The same happens with Android emulators. When testing the platform in our lab and playing around with it, communication between these devices happens by means of XMPP. So we're using this as an infection vector and for devices to communicate with each other and to the CNC server. Some restrictions here in terms of the networking, since, as I said before, for reasons of security, we don't want to mess up with real installations of mobile botnets. We don't have wide internet access connected to the platform. All devices are connected through the Wi-Fi network, through the same Wi-Fi network. This is a restriction that we use just for the fact that it allows us, if the devices are in the same network, to have full interaction with the devices. In theory, we could restrict this scenario and have devices connected from different networks, but we would need to have a telnet daemon running on the different devices in order to be able to communicate with them remotely. an issue that is quite problematic for now is how to set up the topology of the different devices if we wish to have some sort of a custom topology. The thing is that IP addressing is a bit hard when it comes in particular to the emulated devices, because each Android emulator has its own IP behind the virtual router of the Android emulator, and we have to use some port redirecting, a lot of hard-coded port redirecting, in order to fix the desired topology. And another aspect that we plan to work on is, okay, we have, and it's a restriction that we understand that it's there, is the fact that we're using Wi-Fi network, and since we're talking about mobile botnets, we cannot ignore the fact that they might be running on 3G networks, 4G networks. So in collaboration with some other people from our lab, we're going to start working on traffic shaping to emulate the features of the particularities of 3G connections and cellular networks. As I mentioned before, the scenarios are defined using a specific XML schema that I'm going to show to you just for the sake of information. It doesn't really say anything as it is now, but basically what it does is we can define the different types of nodes and the different topologies by means of neighbors, the different steps, the duration of the experiment, different types of conditional and exit conditions to exit the experiments, types of results, and the different steps. In theory, yeah. This is something a bit more user-friendly than writing specific code, but it can be improved, and that's something that we have realized. So we have, as I said before, we define different steps to define the standard executions, and this can be conditionally triggered or triggered by means of specific timers. And let me just briefly cover another complementary aspect that we have been working on. When I said at the beginning we started doing research on mobile botnets and to study their particularities, we had some things in mind. So one of the things that we wanted to test is whether we are able to count the number of active bots in a mobile botnet. And for that, we developed an algorithmic method based on a variant of the Jolly-Seber model. This is a model borrowed from a theory in biology, in order to measure the number of species encountered in the wild, number of zebras, for example, when you don't know the exact number of zebras, and so forth. So this is a completely statistical method, so it's to be understood that it does not give exact and accurate results, but gives a very good indication on the number of bots in the botnet in a relatively short amount of time. So the idea behind this is it's a capture-recapture method. So we have a big population, the entire number of ecosystem of devices, and some of them that are infected with the botnet. So at some point in time, we go and capture some of these devices, and by means of capturing, I mean monitoring their IPs, monitoring their unique identifier, and we mark them. So these four devices at some point in time are marked as having installed a specific mobile botnet malware installed on them. Then we release them by means of releasing. I mean, okay, in the real world, we capture the animal, then we release it in the wild again. Here, we just mark it and keep it for future reference. In another point of time, we have another set of the population, another set of the mobile devices that we are monitoring again. Two of them already existed before in the previous set as well. So we go and recapture the same number of devices, four devices again, and one of them has been captured for the same time. Assuming that there is a normal distribution of mobile botnet malware amongst the set of all devices, the number of devices that was marked for the second time over the number of devices that were marked altogether should be equal to the number of devices that were marked in the first time. So all these, the yellows and the reds. Have been monitored and have been observed by us, so we have these numbers. So we can easily calculate the number of infected devices altogether. As I said before, this is a statistical method and gives an indication of how many active bots are out there in terms of particular mobile botnet malware. But this indication is relatively good and it can become better and better if we have a lot of rounds of capturing and recapturing. And this is an experiment that we are planning to run, the one that we are currently running in our experimental platform. Just as a hint, as I said before, we need to monitor, we need to to see how many devices are actually carrying the mobile botnet malware. When it comes to centralized and hybrid mobile botnets, the way to do this is by means of implementing a specific honeypot in order to monitor infected instances. And in terms of peer-to-peer mobile botnets, it's much easier if we have devices, actual devices of our platform, infiltrate the mobile botnet and periodically collect the number of nodes that are in their peer list in order to communicate with. So let me go to our conclusion slowly so you can have time for questions later on. As we said many times today, mobile botnets are emerging into the scene. They're actually not only running on mobile devices, but they are spurred by the fact that there is a convergence of traditional mobile ecosystems, and it's the pervasive nature of mobile phones, always on, always connected, gives ground to a lot of more serious attacks to occur using mobile botnets. Having said that, there is a need for systematic research efforts to do this in a manner that can be repeated and can be shared by other researchers with other researchers. And in this respect, research has been quite dispersed so far. In this, accordingly, we proposed a hybrid experimental platform in order to study mobile botnets and to highlight challenges and different opportunities. Hopefully, this will be something that can be shared in the next period of time with the rest of you, and we can all make use of it. Thank you very much for your attention, and feel free to ask me any questions you want.
Any questions at this stage? Yes.
Hi, thanks, great talk. Just a question, did you have difference between the actual devices and the emulated devices?
Some of the mobile botnets cannot run on the emulated device in the sense that they can realize that they are running on emulated devices since they are not executing at all. Moreover, there is a matter of resources. So the real device that we have are the latest ones, basically. So they're much more advanced in terms of the resources that they have compared to the previous, to the emulated ones. So that's another aspect that's quite different.
Another question? Tom?
Excellent. So I did a very good job at presenting them.
Hi. Hello. You mentioned peer-to-peer communication. Have you encountered a case of low-level radio communication?
NFC mean?
I mean not over IP, but low-level radio communication using standard radio.
Not, if I have encountered, no, to be honest, the short answer is. But yeah, it could quite be possible. For example, with Bluetooth in a contained environment, could be quite possible. I haven't seen it yet.
Okay.